But I ain't never in my life before seen so many love affairs go wrong as I do today.
Brown stole from me. Brown says, no, I did that first. You stole from me. And conflict ensues.
Soul music, one of the most earliest influences is Mr. Little Willie John. At such a young age, he proved to be one of the most dynamic and influential singers in the early formation of soul music. His 1956 single Fever became a double-sided hit alongside with his other single Letter from My Darling. But it was Fever that grabbed everyone's attention with his slow, sexy lyrics and his braggadocio style that reached number one for 3 weeks on the Billboard R&B bestsellers chart and peaked at number 24 on the Billboard bestsellers in stores. The single sold 1 million copies and has been covered by a lot of people, most notably Peggy Lee in 1958. Little Willie John also contributed to the civil rights movement, singing in a lot of benefit concerts to raise funds for organizations fighting segregation. He influenced a lot of artists ranging from rock to soul, from the Beatles all the way to Sam Cooke. However, despite his success, he was known for his offstage antics ranging from legal issues and alcohol abuse. The alcohol abuse was the one that really fueled his temper, that King Records dropped him in 1963. Fast forward to 1964, Little Willie John's career slowly declined, beginning with the stabbing of Kendall Roundtree after Kendall Roundtree slapped him multiple times. He was sent to Washington State Penitentiary in Walla Walla, Virginia. However, he became appealed to probation when in 1965 he managed to record what would be his comeback album. However, that was not released until 2008. So he was sent to prison in 1966, but he died 2 years later in 1968, where his death kind of sought a lot of controversy because, you know, it was said that he died from pneumonia. There was really no record of treatment. And then all of a sudden they said that he died from a heart attack. And then there's many people who say that he actually got killed in prison. Now, Little Willie John, the reason why he really gets overlooked was because, like, one of the reasons, in my personal opinion, was not a lot of live recordings and not a lot of his singles was like really widely accessible like that, you know what I'm saying? However, I want to jump into King Records because King Records at that time was originally a country music label. A lot of people would forget about that. Founded by Sid Nathan in Cincinnati, Ohio in 1943, it later on became one of the groundbreaking R&B labels. Two of its stars came from King Records alongside Little Willie John, and those are Joe Tex and the godfather of soul himself, James Brown. Now, these two never liked each other. In fact, these two nearly killed each other at one point. And so, I've thought of ways to really start off this video, to be honest with you. And, you know, both acts have been influenced by Little Willie John. And I'm going to talk about Little Willie John in this video too, so stay tuned on that. But I've called James Brown and Joe Tex really like the first quote-unquote hip-hop beat. Because, you know, at that time, you know, I saw the components about beefing, like challenges, you know, calling each other out on stage, check. Fighting over women, check. Ego, check. Shooting up at a club, check. I mean, it's not even funny, man, but this story is going to be one of the most trifling episodes I've ever talked about when it talks about beef. Hi, my name is Reg, and welcome to another episode of Whiter Beef. And in today's episode, we're going to talk about the beef between James Brown and Joe Tex. Now, this shit took place during like the late 50s, all the way up into probably the mid to late 60s too. So this might be like one of my oldest, in terms of timeline, one of the oldest episodes that I've done in terms of the show. And I'm very, very, very excited to talk about this. And when it comes to both artists have left two contributions when it comes to hip hop music decades to come. For Joe Tex, he was the first performer to really drop the whole soul preaching passages, which would later be termed as the rap. And this would be very instrumental when it came to people like Isaac Hayes and Millie Jackson, whom also influenced rappers to come too. Also with Joe Tex, he was also very satirical. Like, he was known for like taking other people's songs and, you know, doing answer tracks or just, you know, making fun of it, you know. This is also very evident, you know, when it came to like Dougie Fresh and Salt and Pepper. Especially when Salt and Pepper, when they first came out, they came out with The Showstopper, which was an answer track to Dougie Fresh and Slick Rick's The Show. You know what I'm saying? And when it came to Joe Tex, he was also, you know, very dynamic when it came to his live performances, which I'm going to talk more about that throughout the video. Now, when it comes to James Brown, I mean, his influence in hip hop should be set in stone at this point. Like, he was known for his like call and response style, and of course, like the rhythm breaks, you know, courtesy of the funky drummer himself, Clyde Stubblefield. You know what I'm saying? Speaking of funky drummer, that's like one of the most sample breaks when it comes to hip hop too. So like James Brown really was like more instrumental. Like, he's not the most sample artist in hip hop history for a reason. Now, both artists were signed to King Records, and they both was pretty much signed within a year apart. In 1955, you know, Joe Tex was performing at the Apollo Theater during like the amateur portion, and he was always known for getting first place. I think he got first place about 4 times, and he was later on discovered by Henry Glover. And Henry Glover, you know, likes his style, and he wanted to offer him a contract to King Records. However, his mom wanted him to graduate from high school first, and you know, Henry Glover had to wait like a whole year before actually signing him at the age of 19. Now, between 1955 and 1957, you know, Joe Tex did not have like a lot of success when it came to King Records. And you know, he was also signed with Little Willie John. And speaking of Little Willie John, he said that he actually wrote the song Fever, but he sold it to the King Records staff so he can pay his rent. And in order like to also say that he wrote the song, he ended up writing an answer track called Pneumonia.
You know that I never did care, and if you put your cotton picking arms around me, I'm gonna hit you with this rocking chair. You gave me pneumonia. Yes, you gave me pneumonia, baby.
And Pneumonia really did not go anywhere, of course, and whatnot. And it was also bad, too, because the people who wrote Fever, Otis Blackwell and Joe Cooley, who Otis Blackwell went by the pseudonym John Davenport, they actually said, oh, we wrote the song Fever and almost for illegal content. And so he left King Records around 1957, ended up signing to Ace Records in 1958. And this was around the time when he was opening for a lot of people, such as Jackie Wilson, Little Richard, and of course, the then rising James Brown. Now, when it comes to James Brown, how he got signed to King Records, him and his group, the Famous Flames, you know, they actually saw Little Richard perform at Macon, Georgia. And what ended up happening was the fact that, you know, they ended up performing when Little Richard was having a break. You know, he had an intermission, and Little Richard liked what he saw, and he ended up getting the group in contact with his manager at the time named Clint Brantley. And Clint Brantley liked what he saw, and so he ended up, you know, getting them at a local radio station where they did like a demo station, and that's when they performed the classic song Please, Please, Please. And so, you know, Please, 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 released in 1956, you know, that actually got them signed to King Records, Federal Subliminary, the King Records Federal sublabel or whatnot. And that's where they re-recorded Please, 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 and it became the group's first R&B hit, selling over like a million copies. Now, even though Please, Please, Please was a big hit, the follow-up records did not really go too well either. It wasn't until, you know, 1958 when, you know, Try Me was a big song.
Try me,
try me.
Prior in 1957, you know, Brown replaced Clint Brantley and hired Ben Bart, who was also the chief of Universal Attractions Agency. And that same year, the original Famous Flame broke up. And that's when, Ben Bart changed the group from the Famous Flames to James Brown and the Famous Flames. Now, the beef pretty much started allegedly around the mid-50s. You know, this is around the time when Joe was getting really familiar with James, and James was getting really familiar with Joe. And Joe Tex always used to say that, oh, James Brown stole my dancing, and James Brown stole from Lil Willie John. And a lot of people, they pretty much agreed with what Joe Tex said, including Little Richard himself. So one time, you know, everyone was chilling, and James Brown pretty much called out Joe Tex for a dance battle at a local juke joint and whatnot. And so this pretty much made Joe Tex mad because of the fact that, oh, now it feels like James Brown is pretty much making fun of me, you know, after Joe pretty much said that, oh, he's stealing from me and whatnot. So what ended up happening was this. So Joe Tex pretty much had a song called Baby You're Right, you know, which was released in 1961. And so what was interesting about this track too was that, you know, James Brown, being that the slick motherfucker that he was, ended up not only taking Joe Tex's song without permission, changed some of the lyrics around, and pretty much made money off of Joe Tex's song. Yo, James Brown was a fucking fool, yo. On some real shit. But yeah, man. And so, to add insult to injury, James Brown pretty much had a bigger hit where his version of Baby You're Right reached number 2 on the R&B charts and actually was actually doing good on the pop charts too. While Joe Tex, you know, his record sales was slowly going down at that time too. So yeah, man, like, this nigga James Brown literally took Joe Tex's song. Not only did he take his song, but he changed some of the lyrics around so he can get publishing rights on that. And this is why, you know, publishing is very, very, very important.
If you think I wanna hug you, then baby, you're right. Oh, yes, I love you. I wanna hug you. I need you all so bad. And when I can't have you, it makes me so mad. If you think I love you, well,
Joe Tex apparently had a girlfriend who was a background singer named Bea Ford, very attractive woman. And at some point, Brown woos her, seduces her, and not only does she leave Joe Tex's band, she leaves Joe Tex.
She became James' woman.
So now, fast forward to 1959, Joe Tex and his wife, Bea Ford, who was also a singer, had divorced. And 1 year later, James Brown, if you thought like what he did prior was shady, this is where the icing really hit the cake, really, when James Brown pretty much collaborated with Bea Ford on a song called You Got the...
I'm leaving you, darling, and I won't be back. I found something better somewhere down the track.
Oh, oh, I need you, darling.
How? And what ended up happening was the fact that James Brown actually wrote Joe Tex a letter saying that, oh, he was through with Bea Ford, and if Joe wanted her back, he could have her. Like, the audacity of this. I'm sorry, but this story always cracks me up, man. So this led to Joe Tex doing what many people believe to be the very first diss track or diss record called You Keeper. Well, he pretty much called James Brown out, and what ended up happening was he revealed to the public that James Brown wrote Joe Tex a letter about his wife. Jesus Christ.
Calling out James Brown by name in the beginning of the song. You know, I taught her how to dress, I taught her how to fix her hair, but you can have her now. And so now, James Brown's whacked out of his mind. James finds out.
James, I got your letter.
Now, fast forward to 1963. James Brown had just dropped his landmark Live at the Apollo album, and he was planning on returning to Macon, Georgia to play a homecoming concert, ironically Joe Tex's opening for James Brown. Now Joe Tex really wanted to stick it to James Brown, he really wanted to make an impression. So what he did was he got this old raggedy ass blanket, fell down on his knees, and said some shit like, please, please get me out of this cape, grabbed his back like he was in pain and stuff like that. The crowd was laughing and whatnot, because it was clear that he was making fun of James Brown. Everybody was laughing except for one person. And you guys know who that person was? James Brown. So, pretty much what happened was, you know, James Brown was pissed. He was fucking pissed that not only were you, like, making a mockery of him, of his stage antics, but she did it at his hometown too. So what ended up happening was that Joe Tex was planning on doing an after show at a local juke joint called Club 15. And James Brown followed Joe Tex there. And this was the same night that Otis Redding and the Pine Toppers were performing there too. And when Otis Redding was performing, James Brown got some of his shotguns and started busting at the place, trying to fire at Joe Tex and whatnot. And so by that time, Joe Tex was already gone. He was already gone. And, you know, Otis Redding, you know, he hid behind a piano, and apparently 7 people actually got injured in a crossfire. Whereas James Brown went back to his tour bus and took off. So, after James Brown took off, a member of his entourage handed out $100 bills to everybody left in the club to keep quiet of the incident. Now, there was plenty of eyewitnesses as to what happened, because people had, like, different versions as to what happened, but Newt Collier, who would end up working with Sam and Dave, said, and I quote, "Joe Tex could imitate anybody he wanted to. You know how James came out with the cape? Joe had one made up out of a raggedy blanket with holes all in it. You know how James would break down and fall on his knees? Joe fell on his knees, and all of a sudden, he grabbed his back. He had the cape on and got all tangled up in it, and he was fighting to get out, singing, 'Please, please, please get me out of this cape.' He just made a mockery of James. Here it was, James' homecoming show, and James didn't appreciate this at all. He went out to Club 15 after the show, and Joe Tex was out there, and James took a couple of shotguns, and I think six people got shot. James did the most shooting, and Joe was running back behind the trees and bushes. So that was the end of Joe Tex James Brown review." Charles Davis said, and I quote, "I was the last one to know what was happening. I'm playing drums with my eyes closed and getting down. The crowd was noisy, and I couldn't hear the shooting. By the time I figured out what was happening, everybody was on the floor, and I'm up there on the stage by myself." Unquote. Wayne Cochran, who was a singer, you know, he said, and I quote, "James said somebody else was in there shooting across the room at each other and reloading. Then neither one of them hit the other. James went outside and I saw his tour bus pull out of the parking lot with him behind the wheel." So yeah, man, pretty much a lot of people just didn't know what to expect, you know what I'm saying? And so what was also interesting was the fact that this was not really the end of their beef, because yeah, the shooting was like the peak of it all, but you know, they still had like a couple of side comments they made with each other over the years. And you also have to remember too that by the mid 60s, both Joe and James Brown was now getting popular in their respective fields. You know, Joe Tex, he for one was actually the first to cut a Southern Soul record in the South and cross over to the US pop chart. And that song was called "Hold On To What You Got."
Hold on, hold on to what you got. You had the better hold on. Hold on to what.
So then, fast forward to 1968, and around this time, you know, James Brown was starting to call himself Soul Brother Number One. And Joe Tex, you know, he had to have Soul Brother Number One painted on his tour bus. Once James Brown, you know, once he found out what had happened, he almost threatened legal action pretty much about it. And this is when Joe Tex had it removed so that he can avoid legal action or whatnot too. And, you know, Joe Tex, he would still, at that time, he would still, you know, say James Brown stole from him, James Brown stole from Lil Willie, and yada yada. But around this time, too, despite having, like, more success that he had seen since the early 60s, he actually converted to Islam. And a lot of his time, he was touring as a spiritual lecturer. And so, fast forward to 1972. You know, James Brown, you know, he had a song called "The Funky Side of Town." And, you know, there was a segment where him and Bobby Bird and Hank Ballard were mentioning, like, different soul stars and whatnot. And so, once they mentioned Joe Tex, James Brown said, "Who?" And you can actually hear that song on the album, "Get on the Good Foot."
Yeah. Nah. Joe Tex.
Who?
Joe Tex.
And, you know, both James Brown and Joe Tex around that time, they pretty much, you know, stay clear of one another and whatnot too. Joe Tex, like I said, he converted to Islam. But around that time too, when it came to like the late 70s to the early 80s, he actually, you know, got addicted, you know, to drugs and alcohol around that time too. And so pretty much, you know, he was getting depressed and whatnot. And so in early August of 1982, you know, Joe Tex was found in the bottom of his swimming pool, apparently drowning and whatnot. And so they managed to save him. But then a few days later, you know, 5 days after his 47th birthday, he ended up passing away from a heart attack. And then, you know, with James Brown too, you know, he ended up, you know, having a lot more success in R&B. And, you know, he still continued, you know, to do live performances, you know, despite, you know, actually going to prison in the late 80s and stuff too. You know what I'm saying? You know, he still had like more a recognizable career than Joe Tex. Because in a weird way, I kind of think that even Joe Tex kind of gets a little overshadowed by James Brown a little bit, you know what I'm saying? And so that concludes the episode of Joe Tex versus James Brown. So overall, no, I guess that's why I call it the first hip hop beef, man, because of the fact that both James Brown and Joe Tex were really going after each other in the most trifling ways that was very unheard of at that time too, you know what I'm saying? And so what ended up happening was the fact that, you know, they both end up being influencers, they both end up being groundbreakers and trailblazers of their culture and of their field too. So personally, I'm just very glad I told the story. Now I got an announcement to make. So originally my next beef episode, it's supposed to have been like based on the Supremes. You know, you guys voted for that one too. However, I'm actually waiting on a source for that one, so I decided to put an alternate episode. So stay tuned on that one. And I want to thank you guys so much, you know, for holding it down. You know, thank y'all so much for watching, and I will see y'all in the next episode. Peace.